then, and they were already panicked. Hillary Clinton was already talking about the fact that, oh my gosh, there are no gatekeepers. That's the term she used. There are no gatekeepers on the internet, and that's what they want. Okay, that's who the big media are. They're the
and by the way, just to interrupt, if you're a new listener, this is not our opinion or a conspiracy theory like Hillary puts in your mind, just a denial button people can push. They release this on the Clinton official presidential library website.
Yeah, by the way, they released only part of it. I'm on my desk as I'm talking to you right now. I have a 331-page report.
Wait a minute. You got the secret one? They only released 30 pages.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, I have the whole thing. In fact, we're trying to figure out how to republish it. The problem with that is there are so many news articles and things like that in this report. We got to go and get reprint permission.
You know, I think it's fair use because it's a government document that's attacking free speech.
Yeah, tell my lawyers.
Give it to me. I'll publish it right now.
Alex, you know how it is. I mean, the laws are there to protect some people, not all the people. And, you know, if I do something and you do something that Media Matters does, suddenly there's a new standard.
They show exhibits of news articles they want shut down. The answer is black out 90% of each news article and then release it. That should satisfy the lawyers.
Exactly. So, you know, the point I'm trying to make here is that they knew what the internet meant for them. And
they were conspiring like the Soviet Union to kill it in its crib.
That's right. To give you another illustration, we founded WorldNet Daily in 1997, May of 1997. At that time, MSNBC.com was far and away the biggest website of any kind in the world. Okay, and I remember looking at that, and I remember saying to myself, my wife, I didn't tell anybody publicly, but I said, we're gonna pass those guys someday. And within a couple of years, if that MSNBC imploded, and rightfully so because of the direction they took, which was, you know, forget about reporting the news, you know, let's indoctrinate the public into a statist mentality, virtually a Stalinist mentality, if you want to, you know, get more specific here, and look at the ratings. This is a combination of Microsoft and NBC, two gigantic, you know, multinational corporations. And look what they've done. They start with the number one website in the world, and look at where they've gone now. They're down hundreds and hundreds of positions over that time. So, you know, what you're saying is exactly right, but I want people to understand, you know, this has been going on for a long time. And by the way, you know, when we first started WND, you know, I realized, oh my gosh, these people are coming after us, right? But we're still here. What is it? 17 years.
But later. Do you agree now that the ultimate counterattack, like we're the Battle of the Bulge, we're the Allies, and the Nazis are about to launch their main assault?
Oh yeah, yeah. We haven't seen anything like this before. I mean, the forces are converging on us in such a symmetrical and pattern. They've been planning this, you know, and we've fought them back. There's been setbacks in their plans over the years, but they never give up. That's the thing about the left, the Stalinist left, is they're in this for the long haul. And you might win a battle here and there, but they just keep coming. And that's what we got to be prepared for all the time. We got to continue that way too. We have to unite. You know, Harry Reid said something, I thought, with regard to this Bundy situation in Las Vegas that was very revealing yesterday. I don't know if you caught it. He said, what we need to go up against this little, you know, rancher in Nevada is we need a united front. You know that terminology, right,
Alex? Absolutely. They're unified in their will to take over this country. That's why I've tried to be unified as well. But what do you do when our supposed own allies turn against us?
Yeah, but I'd like all your listeners to do right now is go Google the term united front and see what that means.
It's communist.
Those are code words. Okay, he's telling the goose-stepping, you know, troops out there that this is a battle that we have to win against Clive and Bundy. You know, and the key was that New York Times article where they labeled him unfairly, unjustly as a racist, took his words out of context, because that's how they get us. Okay, that's how they step. That's how they make sure Sean Hannity and Glenn Beck are not going to support Clive and Bundy.
That's right.
They're not going to oppose it when they steamroll over liberty proponents like Clive and Bundy. And that's how all hell breaks loose.
And by the way, I want to just back you up. Let's put up the definition of the United Front. That's a V.I. Lenin coined term used by the Bolsheviks in 1917, 1918. We'll put it back on screen for TV viewers.
Yeah, it's not a coincidence. He didn't pull that term out of thin air. That has to be ingrained in you. You know, I used to be one of them. I used to be, young kid, but a commie. I knew all of this terminology. I knew what this was about. And, you know, it helps to have that kind of historical perspective when we look at what's going on today.
Meanwhile, it's a bunch of rich insiders using communism as a way to enslave us while they exempt themselves from all the taxes. But people are pointing out how Harry Reid's getting so rich off of all the different things he's running. And so what you're saying is a lot of these so-called conservatives get intimidated by what they see happening, and then they let the left dictate things to them. I think that's part of it. But also, I think it's the fact that they know that there's going to be staged events in this country, like Oklahoma City, that are going to be blamed on the liberty movement. And we just have to be ready for that. I mean, these people are not going to stop. We have to expose Joseph Farah, just how evil they are, so that when they do stuff, people understand that this is a criminal group. And I was ignorant until just the last 7-8 years myself. I thought it was more of a corruption and a corporate New World Order and the rest of it. But now I really realize the left, socialist, communist, are the core of the political ideology that dominates this. And there may be big banks and things funding it because they'll politically take over. But at the end of the day, my enemy really is the grassroots collectivist that hates my guts.
Yeah. And don't, you know, you're still absolutely right about the New World Order and all those things as well. That's a reality. And ultimately, that's their goal. But you know, they try to put it in terms that appeal to the average person. So they attack racism. Do you think they really care about that Clive and Bundy's a racist? I mean, would it be news if he were? No, the point is to not smear Clive and Bundy. They really care about him. What they care about are the people who might line up in support of him. They want to make sure that Rand Paul has to think twice about standing up for Clive and Bundy, that Glenn Beck has to do that Sean Hannity. That's what worries them, when Alex Jones and Farah and Drudge and all these people out there who have some platform actually say, wait a minute, why are you mobilizing this military campaign against this rancher from Nevada? And so what they do is, if there's one degree of separation between you and Clive and Bundy, Sunday, you're on the defensive about, standing up and saying, hey, what are you guys doing with 200 armed troops in the middle of nowhere?
Well, let's expand on that. We have the full video at Infowars.com. Unedited video shows Bundy making pro-black, pro-Mexican comments and basically saying what I knew he was going to say when I called him yesterday. That no, they left one form of slavery for another. But he's saying it sarcastically to get people to talk about it because he's a straight shooter. And then they spin the whole deal. And again, as if the only thing that matters, even if he was a quote racist, they want to paint all property rights or anybody standing up against Tiananmen Square style oppression as a racist. Why don't we just say the tank man from Tiananmen Square? Just say, I heard he was a racist, so let's run him over with a tank.
Exactly. That is, in essence, what they are saying. A perfect analogy. And we have to realize, wait a minute, we're being manipulated here. But they're trying to take the focus off of what the government is doing to this guy, as if they were going after him because he was a racist. You know, I mean, come on. What they want to plant this seed of doubt. Wait a minute, should I really be getting involved with this? That's what Harry Reid wants.
They want to set the Overton window. They want to set the parameters of debate where only what MSNBC says or CNN says with White House talking points is the acceptable political discussion. They want to demonize him ahead of going after him and then stamp everyone else with the Clive and Bundy seal when they go after the next person. The reason it's such a big deal, though, these 95 Clinton memos, is that it shows the authoritarian nature of how they wanted to shut you guys down and not let you be known, that they were so threatened by not controlling everything. I mean, this sounds like something the Soviets would come up with.
Yeah, it really was, and it continues today. The only difference is that from back then, we got this paper trail, you know. We don't have the paper trail yet. That's what they're trying to hide, for instance, with the abuse of the IRS, which is something really extraordinary now. And it's funny to me because at this point, you know, the media has sort of backed off this thing, even though there's been this email chain that's been leaked out in the congressional investigation, which virtually is the paper trail that shows, wait a minute, this wasn't just some rogue agents, you know, in Cincinnati who were doing this. This was coming from the top. And we've got more on that on WND today. But, you know, sometimes you have to bring this home, personalize it a little bit. You know who Gary Aldrich is?
Yes.
Okay, you know what? He's the head of the Patrick Henry Center, been around for a long time. He's a former FBI agent in the White House.
He's the guy that saw them with crack pipes and Mao and Lenin on the Christmas tree. I've interviewed him.
That's right. And he's got the Patrick Henry Center for Individual Freedom, been operating for like 15 years or something. You know, they took his tax-exempt status away. And listen to the rationale here that the IRS says this is the reason. Repeated statements supporting or opposing various candidates by expressing its opinion of the respective candidate's character and qualifications. Now, here's a 501c3 organization. By the way, the specifics they cite was a 2004 column by Gary Aldrich that was unflattering toward John Kerry, and another one, a fundraising letter where he criticized Hillary in 2005.
Well, for those that don't know, folks, with this tax exemption, they buy off speech saying you can't ever have a view. You can't have a anti-abortion group that criticizes a pro-abortion politician. That's asinine. And so the answer is people need to support liberty organizations. We don't take your money at gunpoint like MSNBC with stimulus money or NPR. We don't take it like Obama does and use it against you. We need you to buy our books, our videos, our products to literally fund us while we're under hellish attack. It really comes down to that, folks. We are the tip of the spear. WorldNet Daily, InfoWars, Drudge. Let's list some other people. Patrick Henry Center. Who are some of the others people should support, Joseph?
Well, the Western Journalism Center, which I founded, you know, way back before WND, is still around under new leadership. Floyd Brown, who, by the way, you'll find his fingerprints all over this communication stream of conspiracy commerce, too, because of the things he was doing back then. And what was it? What were we doing back then? We were trying to find out the truth about the corruption in federal government and the Clinton administration. That was our sin. That was what, you know, put us in the spotlight. That's what put us under the microscope.
You'd run some of the biggest newspapers in the country, and how dare you try to bring back old-fashioned journalism.
Exactly.
No, they say in there, oh my gosh, he's investigating Vince Foster. This is, they should be an FBI investigation of this memo. It looks like a criminal racketeering meeting.
You know, the federal government itself conducted three investigations of Vincent Foster as a result of what we had raised. Now, I don't think they ever got to the bottom of it, but the point is, if there wasn't anything worth investigating, why did they have three separate investigations of his death? So, you know, I mean, it's absolutely crazy. History is repeating itself right now. You know, the advantage to being as old as I am is there's nothing new under the sun. We just keep seeing the same tactics wheeled out time and time again.
I know you got to go, but I want to do 3 minutes on the other side because I've got one big question for you, and I'm going to ask it now, Joseph Farah. We're going to go to break, and I want you to come back and answer it.
Sure.
Myself, you, people that have been in this a long time, you longer than I, we get so used to the evil, we almost become acclimated, staring into the abyss, as Nietzsche said. The danger is not realizing how epic what you've done is or what Drudge has done, how epic what InfoWars has done, and that we really are the only ones standing up against this pure evil. This is David against Goliath, and people need to energize us.
We're on the march.